Thank you. Welcome from the Netherlands, where I'm sitting in my lonely office. I'm very happy to be able to present to you, and also given that we have a special relation with Obeyo, and together we are trying to help the industry to improve their way of working. So yesterday we heard some quite interesting talks about Capella, how is it used, today I have a little bit different tech, which is looking at the high-tech equipment industry and see how MBSE and tools like Capella can help them, and where is the match and what are the issues to be solved. And I hope together that will give a picture how to move forward in the future. So the Netherlands has quite some high-tech industry. We have semiconductor industry, high-tech medical equipment, agricultural, but also electron microscopes and printers, etc. All are highly sophisticated equipment with long-living systems concepts and available in many variants. And there's a lot of systems engineering involved, but it's not as formal as in the space and defense industry. And usually the innovation cycles are much more rapid. So how can we deploy MBSE in this type of industry? And what are the challenges, and how can MBSE and tools like Capella help solve these challenges that this industry facing? So I hope to take you on the journey a little bit, what we are now looking towards with our industry partners. So we are a research institute. We have about 55 staff members. We are part of TNO, which is a large Dutch government-based research institute. And pretty much we are focusing on managing complexity of high-tech systems. And by various means, by system architecting, reasoning, model-driven engineering. And the unique fact is that we do that in close together partnership with our industrial partners, and also in a mode of operation which we call industry as lab, so that we do research at the sites of our partners, and really not only figure out new theoretical results, but also learn from their practical problems, experience their way of working, and try out our new techniques and methods in their industrial settings also to validate that. So it's applied research, but we also work then with universities to ensure that also the problems that we encounter and the work is embedded in science. And for that, we also have 5 part-time professors on board at AZ to make sure that we have the connection to science and to the universities in place. I actually like it as a quite interesting workplace. So MBSE, everybody has his own definition of MBSE, so also we have it. And of course, the transition from document-centric to model-centric is a key element of that. But what we are looking at it is, how can MBSE is a part of systems engineering, and it has the focus for us on creating and exploiting models, domain models, as primary means of information exchange and analysis simulation. And that's really a means to achieve the goal of systems engineering, which is to design and manage effective systems. So it's model-based is a means towards the goal of designing and managing effective systems, and that over the full life cycle, including operation, maintenance, upgrades, and eventually disposal of system. So then we aspire that models are the authoritative source for systems engineering, and that they are not add-on to documents, but rather replace them and indeed cover the full life cycle. That's quite a goal, especially if you work with large organization turning out complex systems, how to do this. So it's not that these systems don't use models. So if you look at our partner industries, they use extensively models in all kinds of engineering, CAD models, virtualization, domain-specific languages, simulations, it's all being used. Yeah, and if you go to a large organization, you may arrive at 1,500 tools and 50 different modeling languages, partly standard, partly in-house developed. And they all are used to in order to support development of these complex systems. So it's not that everybody works with documents and only rudimentary tools. Models are very widely used. Now then, the key question is, what is the value of connecting all these models in MBSE? And how can you do this in a meaningful way, such that you create value of that, and especially in the types of industry domains that our partners are in, which also see high variations in delivered systems to their customers. So that's the key question that this industry is facing. Yeah? There is a general belief models help. Yes, models are indispensable, but how can we connect them together, and where is the value of the connected modeling in a single source of truth for these types of industries? And actually, that's not an easy question to answer. So we are working with our partners to see how we can create this added value in going fully model based. So we have started a project, and we are looking at first part of course is where these organizations are with systems engineering in general. If you don't deploy systems engineering, then model based systems engineering is not useful at all. So in start of a research project that we have started with our partners, we first explored, okay, where are they with respect to systems engineering in general? And then you see here a distribution based from initial, there's curiosity to awareness, to they are running pilots, to it's fully deployed in the development cycle, and it's fully deployed in the full life cycle of the system, including operation and maintenance. So there's a good spread, but all in all, there are already quite some companies who have a good deployment of systems engineering. Now, if you ask the same question with respect to model-based systems engineering, then you get another distribution. And the interesting part is that nobody of these industries has yet fully established model-based systems engineering, and neither in development and even less in the life cycle. So yes, there is awareness, there are pilots running, but it's not easy to make the jump from pilots to successful deployments. And the reason for that is that apparently, it's not that easy. There is no cookbook. Yeah? There is no cookbook to achieve value and return of investment on deploying MBSE on an organizational scale. There's a wide belief and that it's helpful, but it's very hard to have quantified studies that say, well, do this and this, and then you will have your return on investment. So we are figuring out with our partners how to get across this hurdle, where the value is, how to get there, and how tools like Capella and methods like Arcadia can help us in this journey. So we have started a study with our partners, and we call it Demystifying MBSE. So we see the tools are developing fast. We want to keep the experience, but also understand together and learn together how we can use it to provide a handle towards the increasing system complexity that we see in our industries in the Netherlands. And we have started this study in the summer of this year. And I will tell you where we stayed. And as good systems engineer, we start with the problem exploration and assess the needs. And from there on, we want to do our experiments and investigate that. But I will first report you on the needs and the investigation topics that we are currently doing right now. So, and the key part is that we are helping the industry, but also the industry is learning from each other, from their specific types of problems and approaches. And we learn from the industry then what the key aspects are and how we can help them. So the motivation, that's probably similar in many industries. There is increasing complexity in the systems. We have some of our companies that have made their solutions so complex that they are an enemy of themselves. So how to keep track of what they have, how they develop, still make improvements, it's very tough. And then furthermore, to create value for your customers, increasingly you have to understand how your customer works. And what is their application flow, workflow? Where does your equipment add value in that workflow? And how can you help them achieve their value? Then the knowledge management and transfer. These companies are large, many people come in, and how to onboard them, how to make sure that they get up to speed in understanding what the system is, what the key drivers are, what the key challenges are, and that not only for their specific detail that they are working on, but also have them understand the big picture. And communication, communication inside R&D is usually, you can talk with technical people, but how to communicate with sales, with product managers, with maintenance people, especially across countries and across cultures. And you see that in these industries, and we'll touch later on it, there's a lot of reuse and platform development to cope with increasing variability in customer demands and to make sure that your development stays efficient. So, and also can you reduce the amount of configurations that you sell in the market by providing differentiation in customer value with the same components? And of course, process and quality improvement, improving efficiency, reducing inconsistencies, better creates, better links, software and system engineering is also key of those aspects. So this is my favorite Acadia picture. It's a very clear workflow. And we are asking ourselves, so how can we as high-tech equipment industry make use of it? And what are our challenges? Now, if our map our challenges on this picture, then this is the situation where we are in. Well, firstly, these systems have a very long lifetime, and also the concepts are often 20, 30 years old. So there's a huge legacy of existing components, know-how, but it's still working and it's effective. But it's all created before the time there were models, and it's all created with people who may in the meantime have left and work elsewhere. And then if you see these large systems, they have stable functional decompositions. The functions don't change too much over time. The way they work and the way they are realized and the improvements are very, very can differ, but the large functional decompositions are stable, and often you see that the organization is also organized around these functional decompositions. That's the Conway's law, that the organization follows the decomposition of the systems. So they will also not change so much. And then if you look at how innovation is done, it's really done very, very incrementally. There are short cycles that needs to be achieved. So it's not that you scrap a system and then start completely fresh, but you try to improve and innovate and sometimes reorder, but it's very incrementally. And also there you need to cope with. And finally, there's a whole drive for efficiency and dealing with varying customer demands. So there's a high drive to create solutions from platforms. And that means that you create concepts for which you don't know to which customer you are going to sell it. So you have to figure out whether your platform can offer enough to customers that you have not met yet. So how to include flexibility in your platform such that you can create solutions from it for demanding customers without doing too many specials. If you cannot meet a certain customer and their demand, then you have to make a one-off solution for that particular customer. And that's typically something that you would like to avoid. So we're looking into it and we'd like to marry it with this type of workflow and tools and see how we get there. So let me at least show you some of the investigation topics that we are looking into for this type of work. And of course, the software content is very large and growing in this aspect. And software is one of the key drivers now for value, and the amount of software is huge and the innovation is very fast. So let me show you one system, how it developed from ancient times, which is, this is a X-ray machine for medical device to make X-ray images. This is how it looked in 1955. You see a C-arm, you see an X-ray emitter and a detector, zero lines of code. And then over many, many generations, it evolves. Let me see if I get it. To a concept like this, where you still see the X-ray emitter, the detector, the C-arm, but it's a totally different system, albeit it has still the same concepts, and it can be delivered in many variants and different geometries. It can integrate with third-party tables, different monitor configurations, so there are many variants. But it's still a very evolutionary approach. So you never start fresh, but it sort of evolves over time from simple to the current variations. So for our study, we have identified therefore four themes, which is, one is, okay, how can we do this incremental brownfield development with MBSE? How can we then address the large need for knowledge management and transfer? That's not only the new people coming on board, but also capturing the knowledge of old people leaving while these systems are still in the field. How can we make configure to order solutions from platforms? So can we make our R&D efficient? And especially also the last one, how do we connect software to systems engineering? And I would like to go in four topics a little bit in detail, and the first one a little bit more in overview, and then the last one will give you some examples also based on our partner industry. So here's an example. If you have a mobile phone, this is in your phone, and this is from one of our partners, ASML. And if you look at the nanometer level, you see very detailed channels, which in the latest mobile phones, you're talking about a few nanometers, and these layers have to be stacked with 1.5 nanometers accuracy on top of each other. So very small details. And if you look at the production equipment for the critical step, the lithography step, it's huge. And you see that to make these types of machines, and this one and also the previous generation, there are 24,000 people working, 123 nationalities across the globe, 60 locations, etc. So small projects, huge machines, and huge engineering complexity. So how to cope with this? And especially, well, every Christmas, you will hopefully want to have a new Christmas present, which is faster and better than the year before in your electronics. So also they have to innovate rapidly. So what they do, And this is with ASML. They have worked out an approach to innovate rapidly on these long living systems. Now, and then the question is, how can we do this better with MBSZ? And the way they work is, okay, look at small increments, ensuring that most of the system stays the same, but really rapidly figure out what are the options to improve. Start from system level, push it down very rapidly to from the function to the module to the mono level to figure out, does it work? Come back very rapidly to have the lower levels model, prototype, whatever to need to see whether the improvement works or not. If it works, great. If not, then we will revise the upper level and do the same iteration. So really working with very rapid iterations to figure out what are the next improvement steps to make. And this is really, they pride themselves on, okay, we are risk hungry. So we want to make steps where possible, and we don't wait until we know everything. We want to understand and set aside the largest risk, but not wait until we know all the risks. So how can we apply MBSE in this type of situations? And of course, that links very much with knowledge management. In order to do these increments, you really have to understand how your product works, how it evolves over time, what is good, what is not so good, where you learn, and also how can you transfer this knowledge from the old hands to the new people such that they understand not only how it works, but also why it works, and what were the trade-offs and dilemmas that were found and addressed in previous generations. And especially to understand that small changes should have small impact, that not one change makes a huge impact through the machine. And there are a number of issues like vibrations, temperature control, that may have impact throughout the machines or have cross relations, which you try to avoid. So really how to reduce the dependency on these old people. Huh? There are a number of people who have made for this type of machine the entire 30-year journey from very simple to the way it's now working. How can you reduce the dependency on those people, and how can you transfer the knowledge and keep the knowledge if they eventually move away or retire? So we're really looking into that, how we can apply MBSE to this type of issues. Then the third investigation topic is really how to use MBSE for configure-to-order solutions out of platforms. Now, one of our industries, and I'm picking here from Maarten Verhoeven from Van der Landen, works in the area of logistics now, and that can be if you these days order your stuff online, then there are warehouses from large vendors like Amazon which deliver, which make sure that your goods are there in one day. Well, they have huge warehouses and they have to figure out what you ordered, how to get it to you, and how to make sure that it gets rapidly to your doorstep. You can only do this in a variation if you try to make your platforms and your solutions standard on the inside, but be able to cope with the outside, the flexibilities of your customers. So if you look here at a goods to picker, from the warehouse, bringing goods to a picker who basically put your goods in the box that you will get your goods in, then there are a number of configuration issues. It can be manual, it can be automatic. You can different ways of feeding in, feeding out. And there are, if you have 16 configurations, you can have already 150,000 types of variants. So the key question is how you make sure that you are flexible on the outside and standard on the inside. And the solution is there, really looking at, okay, what type of platform can I design such that I can offer my customers the most flexibility, and that also my salespeople can offer the required solution to the customer who have quite demanding requirements. And also, how can I design it such that while I'm delivering customer solutions, also I can evolve my platform over time and still do the service on the old delivered systems to my customers. So the interesting part is there, it's not so much the model, but how you do the modeling. You really have to understand then the business of this type of company and how it works, and try to capture the business in one language and the modular reference architecture to really capture, okay, so how are these, what are the essential characteristics of these product ranges, which can be warehousing, parcel, it can be in this case also airports, luggage systems. How can I capture that in domain model, domain meta models? And then how do I ensure that my modules, which can be the picker modules or the storage modules, what are the key characteristics of those? And gluing it all together is then your platform meta model, which is really your common language across your business that support this, this common domain model definitions where you can drive this. So it's not so much the actual designing, but it's really organizing how you run your business with models. And that's a huge challenge. And that's an interesting journey that Van der Land is now taking on. And it also means that these types of solution need two MBSE approaches. One is, so how do I design this platform? How do I ensure that my platform are configurable? They are modular and have the enablers to compose them. But also, how do I create solutions from them? So then I need to be able to couple these modules and configurators to the requirements of the customer and make sure that I can validate that a particular solution meets the requirements of my customer. And of course, customers are quite quite demanding. This so you have to ensure that you do that. So and one solution is then one part is how do you manage your complexity in terms of your platform? And the other one is how do I hide this complexity for my customer and for my salespeople? Because your salespeople don't want to look in very complex models, but they basically want the Lego blocks to click together and tell when yes, it works and how this is how much it costs. So these are the types of issues that we are looking into how we can do this and how we can link models and tools in order to achieve this type of business challenges. Finally, software content is growing. It's grown beyond mechatronics in most, in a lot of the industries to very complex optimization and analysis software, and there's a lot of innovation. It's much more rapid than in hardware development. And to get the value out, we increasingly need to understand how we arrange the software and the models, and how we prove that software service deliver also the solution that we promise our customers. So here you have an example of an electron microscope. It's a very highly complex machine, also looks at below nanometer accuracy, but it's also a very much a data and software problem. So terabytes of data come from the machines and that must be processed over and over and over again to achieve the images that are of value of the for the particular customer, and in this case, a 3D reconstructions. So how to couple this and how to also decouple the innovation of the hardware from the slower innovation of the hardware from the more rapid innovation of the software, and how to cope with all the variants. Now, one of the interesting things of this application, that this looks far from your bed, but even today in the Dutch newspaper, these types of machines are also used for the COVID crisis. So here you're looking at an image of COVID, generated by these types of machine. Yeah, and this is quite different from the pictures you usually see in the news, how COVID looks real life. So it also really affects the current COVID crisis, which is the interesting part for people. Now, one other example here is that increasingly we're using at virtualization to do early validation for software and for systems and to obtain field feedback. And if I take the example here of an image guided therapy system, which uses X-ray to look at certain aspects of the body of the patient while the surgeon is operating, then typically the surgeon is not looking at the machine, but it's looking at the screen where his stent is going through the arteries of the patient and how he does his operation. Now, there are many variants of these types of systems in the field, and often there are upgrades. So how to test these upgrades or how to test new procedures with physicians without physically having access to the configuration or all the configuration in the systems. So here we're looking at virtual cath labs, as we call them. So it's a combination of, in this case, of real parts like the user interface, real control hardware and software, but virtual geometry and especially virtual X-ray, very safe. And here we can test both with physicians or with surgeons, new procedures and workflows, but also test software in the loop. And I'll show you two short images of that where we are experimenting with Philips. So here you see an early prototype where in this case you can control the virtual machine from the real control hardware and the user interface. And in this way, we can rapidly improve, get feedback from real surgeons on how new procedures or new workflow or even new geometry can help them and whether it helps to improve their surgical procedures in the hospital. And the same type of stuff we also using here in run model-based tests on a virtual system. Now, there are a lot of physical systems available in the factory for testing, but even if you have 15 systems in test bays available, there are many more configurations in hospitals and over past generations that you can build up. So one of the key challenges, if you upgrade some software or improve some aspect, so how can you test it over the various configurations that are out in the field and deploy that then to hospitals in the field for an upgrade or an update for things that needs to be done. So model-based will help us, and this virtual or mixed reality will help us to really test also software with partially virtualized system concepts. So this brings me to my summary. Yeah? So we are doing this study, and we're looking at what our needs are, is really improving the system oversight and improving how we deal with legacy and diversity in these types of systems are really what makes MBZ interesting for the high-tech industry. And we have identified four topics that we are working on, and we are experimenting with Capella also to see how we can make this fit. We hope to bring an update on the next ASI symposium to share our experiences and other means. And if there's a new Capella Day, we are happy to join that as well. So with this, I would like to thank you for giving me the opportunity to explain sort of where the high-tech industry is going and what their needs are with respect to model-based. And I would like to invite them, the youth, for questions and also to see jointly how we can make this happen also with Capella and tools like that. So thank you very much.
You're welcome, Tom. Thank you for your presentation. We don't have any question for now, but I'm sure that we have some in a few moments. We have no, yes, 5 minutes for questions. So
one thing I would like to know from the audience maybe is how do you show your effectiveness of MBSE deployment? And how do you create a return on investment? That would be really nice.
Yeah.
But I see there are some questions.
Yes, we received a few. The first one, are there any papers available about this research?
What you saw, the last ones on the virtual cat lab, there is a paper by Springer, and actually in the Springer book, that we can provide. On the research itself, the study project they are doing, there is not yet a document available, but I'm sure that in the coming months we will publish something, and the presentation will be made available to the audience. So I can share that. I have to look it up, but on the virtual test platform, that work is it published in the Springer book of the Enablers 3 project.
Okay, thanks. And next question, where are your numbers coming from in regards to the question, where is your organization with respect to system engineering?
So our members, so we are a, and then I have to go to the beginning. We are a research organization that works with partners, and our partners are mostly from the Netherlands. So companies like ASML, Semiconductor, Philips are well-known names. Van der Lande, if you go to any airport, then you probably will use, your luggage will use Van der Lande systems. So they are mostly Netherlands-based, but also we work with the Netherlands division of Thales, very well-known in France, I suppose. And we work with them in joint research projects.
Okay, thanks for that. And probably the last question. Have you investigated the further downstream aspect of your models in a PLM system, including integrated simulation?
Yeah, we don't focus very much on PLM per se, in terms of manufacturing yet. Key question, the integrity of the model is key, right? How do you know that what you model is also matching reality? And that's a difficult question to answer. So part of it, what we do with this virtualization, then you really can test it very much. And also running models and reality in parallel. So if you go to the digital twin topic, there is also a key aspect how you can calibrate your models with respect to reality. And pretty much the approach we take, but it's already from the past, is that if you develop models, the first thing you have to do is what we call predict past. You model something that is existing or is already existing, and then you predict what it actually is, the real system is doing. And that's a very nice way to calibrate and to figure out your problems. And if you have predicted the past and you have calibrated your models, then you can start predicting the future. So making changes, new things, and then take it from there. But then you know that your basic concepts of your model are sound because they are validated with existing systems.